All right, welcome, folks, to another edition of Ranking the Songs today. So we're taking a break from albums. We're going into ranking the songs. And who do we have to help me rank the top 10 songs of Kansas? None other than Mr. Davey Cretin from Cretin Classics. Welcome.
Hi, thanks for having me again, Joey.
So we're once again talking Kansas. Obviously, we did a Kansas album ranking with you couple months back, and you did another one, I guess, on your site as well. Is that correct?
Yes. Actually, we did ours last year. Me, you, and Tom. We did it, I think it was in October. So it's like 6 months ago.
Seems like yesterday in some respects.
Yeah, October, November. The three of us did an album ranking of Kansas. And then I did one on my channel a few weeks back on Cretin Classics.
So you're like all dialed into the Kansas there. So that's why I figured, hey, it's a good time to probably quickly do a quick top 10 songs, because I mean, this band has so much material for all the albums they have out. And you know, and obviously, you know, you came in a different era of Kansas, I came in at a different time, so we both have different views of the catalog. So to get your view, to get my view, and then people can decide for themselves, you know, where they fall in between. But you know, we want to let them know what our top songs are, and we'll see how many we agree on and go from there. You know, I would say, considering the amount of songs in the catalog, I would say even if five songs, maybe six even, show up on both our top tens in any manner, that would be kind of amazing, actually. But we'll see.
I will make a guarantee we have no crossover.
What do you mean?
None of the same songs.
At all?
That's what I'm thinking. Maybe
wow.
One.
Oh, well, we'll see. Well, it could happen, you know.
I think it will.
All right, well, we'll see what we got. Do you have anything to say about Kansas before we dig in?
Arguably the biggest and best progressive rock band. They formed in the early 70s in middle America. And it took a bunch of years, not till their fourth album, Left Overture, when they had the hit with the classic song, Carry On Wayward Son. That's when they hit the zeitgeist and everybody loved Kansas. They got radio airplay. They sold millions of albums. Their next album had two big hits, Dust in the Wind, and then the title track, Point of No Return. They had some hits in the 80s, and they're still touring today. And they're making new records that are also very fine albums. And I would say Kerry Livgren, the guitarist, keyboard player from the original run of the band from the early 70s till about 83 or so, he is the best American progressive rock songwriter. Guy writes amazing songs.
Oh, that's a pretty strong statement. But if you think about it, a lot of the progressive rock bands are mostly, a lot of them are from the UK. So
exactly.
To say that about the American version, yeah. Yeah, that's pretty much spot on there. I mean, I couldn't even tell you too many people that I would even think of that could top that.
There's one guy who comes close, Neil Morse, formerly mm-hmm. of Spock's Beard, and he's in Flying Colors, Transatlantic, the Neil Morse Band, a bunch of bands. He's a great songwriter, too. And like Kerry Livgren, he became a born-again Christian, so a lot of his lyrics have that slant to it, a religious bent. That's his ideology, just like Mr. Livgren.
All right. Well, without further ado, let's dig in. Let's see what's cooking in Cretin's kitchen there.
Nice. I like that. That would have been a great name for the channel. Oh, well, it's too late now. Coming in at number 10 from, let's see when this is from. From the year 2000, from a record that did not chart, but a record that I love. Somewhere to Elsewhere, Icarus 2, 7 minutes and 17 seconds of progressive rock. And this album saw the original classic lineup coming back together. Dave Hope appears on bass, very underrated bass player. And of course, Kansas's drummer, Phil Ehart, an amazing drummer who never gets any love. They have a great rhythm section. And the great thing about Kansas is they all play together as a unit. It's not like with Van Halen, where you have Edward Van Halen, and he's the greatest, and the other guys sort of support him. These guys all come together and meld together to make a perfect progressive rock stew. And this is a sequel to a song from 1975 called Icarus Born on Wings of Steel. And maybe we'll be hearing more about that later. But Icarus 2 is a great song. The only minor, maybe bad thing about it is that by this point, Steve Walsh's vocals weren't what they used to be from wear and tear on the road and other stuff, that his vocals aren't in tip-top form like they were in the 70s into the late 80s, I would say. So that's a minor quibble, but the song itself and Kerry Livgren's songwriting, amazing. Just a powerful, great song. So Icarus 2 is my number 10.
Okay. My number 10, we're going to go back to the 80s. 1986, to be precise. And we're going to take this song off the Power album. And it's probably one a lot of people aren't too familiar with. But at the same time, it was released as a single, but it just never charted. It was the third single released from Power. And that's none other than Can't Cry Anymore, which features a great Walsh vocal. I've always dug this song. I always thought it was a really good song that kind of never got its just due. And, you know, it's a typical Kansas song from that era, you know, with the keyboards and, you know, kind of more keyboard heavier, more ballady than, you know, some of their other work, obviously. But that was the sound of the 80s, you know, and Power, you know, obviously features another Morse on guitar, none other than Steve Morse. And, you know, it was a whole different band at that point, obviously. And they had just gotten, you know, that was Steve Walsh's return after he had left in 1980. It was his first album back. So, you know, the album definitely, it kind of brought him back into the limelight a little, because they had some hits, minor hits on the album that got some airplay and MTV exposure and all that. And, you know, we might hear more about this album later on, maybe, perhaps.
Oh, I think we will. I was predicting that. Two things, if I could add about that song.
Yeah.
There's a very cool video for it that features the late, great comedian actor Richard Belzer as the producer in the studio. So look for that video on YouTube. It's a cool, when you're done with this video, check out that video of Kansas doing Can't Cry Anymore. And it's also a cover song. It's not one of their songs. It's a rare Kansas cover song. I can't think of who does the original, but I know it's a cover.
Interesting. Yeah, who would have thought at that point they would actually, you know, do a cover, you know, because it was a comeback album. But they did hide it on the album. It's the last song. It was by a band called The Producers.
That's it.
They were a power pop band, new wave power pop band from Atlanta, Georgia.
Yep.
And, yeah, so that's another nice piece of information that I didn't even know. So thank you for bringing that to our attention. See, you learn a lot. Even we learn on our channels here, which is always a good thing. The more you learn, the more you know. You know what I mean?
Sounds like a tagline from somewhere.
All right. What do you got for number 9? I'm curious to find out after your number 10.
Okay, number 9 is a song that clocks in at 5 minutes and 39 seconds. This record, unlike the last one, did chart. It reached 114 on the Billboard charts. And sticking with your theme, I'm staying in the 1980s. 1988 from In the Spirit of Things, an underrated concept album, Bells of St. James. Excellent song. It's proggy. It's memorable. And I just love, even though it's not Kerry Livgren didn't write this song, it's just a powerful song. And just when that chorus comes in, or the Bells of St. James still ringing, I'm not going to sing it because I can't do Steve Walsh, but it just has such an oomph. And I just love when that chorus comes in, when it hits you. And again, it features Steve Morse, like you said, plays guitars on this album and the Power album. So that is my number 9 from 1988's In the Spirit of Things, Bells of St. James.
All right. Very good. Which is another album closer, as that closes out that album.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. All right. So we got a little theme going on here.
Yeah,
All right.
Two in a row. Who knew?
Yeah. Well, my number nine knew. My number nine goes back to an album that I considered the best Kansas album. And that's none other than 1977 we're going back to, because not only did he knew, Portrait he knew. Number nine from the Point of No Return album. I've always enjoyed this song. I actually have their Live at the Whiskey CD, and that's where I kind of really got into this song, because I didn't have Point of No Return. So this I got this CD for the whiskey one. Man, it must have been the early 90s or somewhere along the line. I think whenever it came out, I don't know. It was one of those
1992.
92. So I figured it was the early mid 90s, yeah. So that had this song on there, and I said, "Oh, this is great. I love this song." And then it made me go back and dig into the catalog further, because at that point, I was familiar with all the hits, but not all the other songs. And I also remembered, I think it was 96, I saw these guys open for Styx on the Return to Paradise tour, and they played it as well. So when I heard it again, I said, "Oh man, this song is great." And sure enough, it's definitely kept its very near and dear to me now, because it's reached number nine here out of the catalog, which is just a great song that I still enjoy thoroughly to this day. Great, probably the it's probably the third best song on the Point of No Return, if that makes a little bit of hint of what might be coming down the road here. But
a few more. I knew
solid
it.
solid song though, very solid. Number nine for me.
Okay, coming in at number eight for me is a record that went gold for Kansas. The album reached number 70 on the charts, and it came out in 1975 from the Mask album. The original, Icarus, Born on Wings of Steel, coming in at 6 minutes and 3 seconds. And this is the original song. It's got great guitar riffs in it. And it's a powerful power rock song. And Walsh's vocal is up there in the stratosphere. Amazing. And just the whole band come together for this great prog, mini prog rock epic. And it's a fan favorite for many years. And I've loved it for a long, long time. Icarus, Born on Wings of Steel. That is my number eight.
Nice. All right, number eight. Wow, we're digging. We're getting deep already here. So not quite to the meat and potatoes yet. We're still working on our salad here. But it's like I got, for my number eight, I'm digging into putting a little Italian dressing on here. And I've got Chasing Shadows from the Vinyl Confessions album.
That's a deep cut.
Yes. Well, it was. It charted on the rock charts, not on the top, the top 40, but it did chart on the rock charts due to airplay, I guess. It was receiving some airplay there. I think it was released as a single, but it just never really got much, much love at that point, because of the fact, by the time it was released, the album kind of was already falling off the charts. But, looking back on it, this is definitely Hides. It was actually written by John Elfante, and I'm assuming that Dino is the other guy on that one there that co-wrote it.
Yeah, his brother.
His brother, yeah. So those two wrote a couple songs together on this album, actually. Vinyl Confessions. They wrote Right Away and Face It together. So, yeah, I would say this song is definitely coming in at 3 minutes and 20 seconds. It's one of those classic Kansas 80s songs, but I just love the beginning, the way the keyboards come in and everything, and the vocal performance is top notch. This song to me is just one of those deep cuts that you just don't hear, and these are the kind of songs I really enjoy, because it's like the more you hear it, because it's not something that was overplayed or hardly played at all. If you ever heard it, you probably wouldn't even know who it was, because of the fact it wasn't Walsh singing, and most people associate Kansas with Walsh. Mm-hmm. But I think it's just a great song, and that's why I've got it here at my number eight.
Okay. Nice one. That's a deep cut. I like that. Moving on, number seven. A song that clocks in at 6 minutes and 44 seconds. The album charted, I mentioned it earlier, at number 114 in 1988 from In the Spirit of Things. Another song, Rainmaker. An epic song with a great choir on it, which adds so much. It's just a beautiful, majestic song. Starts out very low key, and then it builds and builds until the choir comes in, and it's just a little mini epic Kansas song. I love it. Rainmaker from In the Spirit of Things, another cool, deep cut. And it's proggy too. I love my Kansas proggy, and I think you like your Kansas a little more poppy.
That's why you get the best of both worlds when we do these rankings.
Yep.
You know, you're going to get the stuff that I like, the stuff that you like's different, and, you know, we get a good mix here. So far we've got, well, we'll see after this one, but I can tell you, after looking back and taking some drastic measures here, that so far out of our top seven through number 10, we don't have one at all that's the same. So that's good.
Goose egg, zero.
So my so number far. Seven was definitely a song that got a lot of airplay through MTV. So obviously that means we're going back to the 80s once again. But this time it's the early 80s. And we're going back, like I mentioned, to Drastic Measures, which was the second album with Mr. Elefante singing, which peaked at number 41. And the song we are talking about was probably the most well-known song from that album, and it's one that they still play live in concert today from that album. So you can probably guess I'm about to mention the song that reached number 58 on the charts, and that's none other than Fight Fire with Fire.
I knew it.
1983. Yeah, I remember. Song. Yeah, yeah. I remember seeing these guys in Lockport, New York. I think it was 2013-ish, 12-ish, somewhere around there. And they left. They came back for the encore. Sure enough, there it was, Fight Fire with Fire, right in the encore. So, you know, and I remember back then Walsh was singing. So this is one song he particularly did not mind singing because they always sang it. He didn't have to. He could have said
yeah,
no.
Saw him do it.
Yep. He played it quite a few times that I've seen him. And the other big hit with Elefante, I only saw him sing it once, which would have loved to seen that one too more. But yeah, Fight Fire with Fire, definitely one of the highlight from Drastic Measures, and just a fantastic song. And that's my number seven.
Well, to piggyback on the comment you made, there are certain singers who are cool with singing other singers' material that were in the band when they had left, and then the original singer came back. Bruce Dickinson always sang the Blaze Bailey stuff, a couple of songs from those mid-90s Iron Maiden albums when he came back. And Walsh sang a couple of songs like play the Game Tonight. That is Walsh. But no. He sang Fight Fire with Fire, and he sang maybe one or two other songs that Elefante had sung with Kansas. So there are some singers that do, and then there's people like John Anderson from Yes, never did anything from Drama.
And you won't see him doing anything from anything else from either.
And Rob Halford never sang any of the Ripper Owens songs from Priest when he came back. So it depends on the band and the singer.
Yeah, Steve Holgarth sang Fish songs, and he still does to this day. Every now and then he'll throw a couple Fish in there. So you got a different, like you said, they all, it depends on how they feel about, number one, the songs, and, you know, preserving the history of the band too. I mean, for Fish, he had so many classic, iconic songs with Marillion, and there's so many people out there today that still cherish the Fish era. You know, even though Hogarth is still, you know, the band really grew with him. You know, compared to where they when they first started with him, where they are now, it's a whole different ball game. But you know, like you said, Walsh did not shy away from singing these songs, which was great. So, well, we're going to dig in number six now. We're getting down now. We're getting to the meat and potatoes, I would say.
There's one more singer who refused to sing any stuff when he wasn't in the band. Ian Gillan from Deep Purple never did any songs from the David Coverdale era. He never did Burn. He never did Stormbringer. All those great songs wiped away.
But
because Gillan refuses to sing them.
But he did sing Hush, which he didn't sing on the original recording. So, but that's a cover, so that might be a little bit different.
Right. But I guess he feels, I think sometimes it comes down to ego with these singers. I didn't write it, I'm not singing it type of thing. I wasn't in the band, I refused to sing it. That's how I think Ian Gillan sees things and the way John Anderson sees things. Maybe they have a little more ego than some of the other guys we mentioned. But moving on, coming into my number six, a record that went platinum in Kansas's canon. It hit number 10. It was a top 10 album from 1979, the Monolith album, Side One, Cut One, 6 minutes, 26 seconds, On the Other Side. Probably it's the last Kansas album from the 70s and the last vestiges at the time of them being like a pure prog rock band where they always had prog song on their first six albums. And On the Other Side is just a great song. It has a great build. And when that chorus comes in with Walsh and Steinhardt singing, turn around, it's On the Other Side. And there was cracks beginning to show in the band because this is when Kerry Livgren had become a born-again Christian, and that's what the song was about. And Steinhardt and Walsh didn't like the direction that the band was going in. They thought it was a little too overtly Christian and just praising God too much. But On the Other Side is a great song, and I love it. It's got a great middle section. There's a cool video for it, too. Great song. Love it. On the Other Side is my number six from Monolith.
Nice. And you may be hearing more about that one later in this episode, but later. All right. Interesting. All right. So my number six is a very interesting song. It comes to us from 1980, the peak of the 80s here, right at the very tip of it. The Audio Visions album, which cranked in at number 26 on the charts and went gold, and to this day remains the band's last charted album, hard to believe.
Yeah, last certified album.
Yep, and that is none other than the song that I'm pulling from this album is none other than the single that made the top 40 by the skin of its teeth at number 40, and that is Hold On. A gem written by none other than the aforementioned Kerry Livgren. And oddly enough, you mentioned about his Christianity here. That's what the song is about. It's about trying to convince his wife to convert to Christianity. I mean, who would have thought? But this song definitely is a highlight of the catalog. It's on the greatest hits. It's just a great vocal by Walsh. Oh, you know, I'm glad it at least made the top 40, even though it only got right at the peak of it there, ran the tip of the iceberg. It was the band's 13th single and 8th top 100 hit, and it was their 5th top 40 hit. So, very cool song, and definitely one of the highlights of the catalog for me, coming in at number 6.
Excellent choice. Okay, we're hitting the top 5. My number 5 is a song that is longer than 10 minutes. Oh me, oh my.
Wow.
At 10 minutes and 3 seconds from a gold record, 1975. Song for America is the album. The record peaked at number 57 on the Billboard charts and the title track, Song for America. It's an amazing song. And I know a lot of Kansas fans might even see it as their number one song. And it's an epic song. Kerry Livgren wrote and conceived this song when he was flying from one coast to the other and just looking out an airplane window. And it just inspired him to write this song all about America. And Walsh's vocal performance, phenomenal. The instrumental sections are amazing. And this is just a highlight in their whole catalog. Song for America, title track from 1975. is my number five song.
All right. Perfect. All right. So my number five is probably a song that's well-loved and well-known throughout the catalog. It was also the name of an album that came out in 1977 that went four times platinum. None other than The Point of No Return and the title cut, Point of No Return. So we both have a theme there. Both of us have a title cut for our number five there.
Yes.
And what can you say about this one? Still on the radio today. You know, some people may say it's overplayed because it's one of the few songs that you always hear on the radio by Kansas. Shamefully enough. I mean, obviously, it's not their fault that the radio decides to only play, you know, songs like that one and a couple others that you hear all the time on a regular basis, you know. But considering the immense size of the catalog, you know, it's nice when you do actually hear a deep cut on classic rock today. You seem to enjoy it more, you know, when you hear something that you don't always hear every day. And but having that be said, Point of No Return, it's a song that no matter how many times I hear it, I do not get sick of it, you know, and that's something that's not easy to do nowadays because you listen to certain songs. Good example, Pour Some Sugar on Me, Def Leppard. It's like, it seems like although they got 300 other hits out, that seems to be the one song radio loves to focus in on. I don't understand why. You know, there's certain songs, if you never hear them again, you probably wouldn't miss them. But this one, no matter how many times I hear it, I will never get sick of it. And that's how, that shows you the staying power of the song, you know. Point of No Return, my number five.
It's a very catchy song. It's got that great violin in the chorus, which is a hook. It's a very hooky song. And if memory serves, it was written by Steve Walsh, the singer, keyboard player, Robbie Steinhardt, and I think Phil Ehart, the drummer. So it definitely wasn't written by Livgren. So it's different. It's compact. It's short. It's, what, 3 minutes, 40 seconds? So that's why, it's one of the reasons the radio plays it so much. Basically, classic rock radio plays three Kansas songs. It's like they play three Blue Oyster Cult songs, the same songs. Godzilla, Burning for You, and Don't Fear the Reaper. And with Kansas, it's Dust in the Wind, Point of No Return, and of course, Carry On Wayward Son. And they have, both bands, and a lot of tons of other bands, have great songs that you just never hear on the radio anymore because everything is now done through the corporations and the DJs can't pick their own songs. Mm-hmm. And radio stinks nowadays.
Yeah,
sorry, I didn't mean to go on a rant.
Yeah, I was just talking about, you know, we see these radio DJs getting to interview these bands nowadays. It's like, and they ask such dumb questions. I mean, these DJs, they have no clue about these bands nowadays. You know, here you are interviewing, just for throw an exit name out there, Motley Crue. Here you are interviewing Motley Crue for a quick segment about their upcoming new songs that they recorded and all this garbage. And here you are asking a question that, what kind of answer were you expecting? It didn't really matter. The question was just dumb to begin with. Dig deeper, act like a fan without coming across as a fan, you know, be interested. It sounds like the guy knew nothing about the bands basically. So he's just asking questions that really made no sense, you know, and that shows you how classic rock has, you know, these radio stations have lost touch with a lot of these things on the bands. They don't know updated or current information. You never hardly ever hear them go talk about a new album the band might have out. Even if they don't play the song or the album, there's no reason in the world why they just can't mention it. Oh, by the way, they got a new album out. Make sure you check it out. You know, something, nothing. You never hear nothing.
They might say, well, down here, they do say that. They promote the concerts, but they'll never play the new single. Maybe the Rolling Stones got airplay. I don't even listen to New York classic rock radio that often, so I'm not even sure if they played the new Stones single last year. But they'll say, oh, they're coming to town, go see them live, but they won't give the album any airplay. McCartney's records never get airplay and he's still putting out decent stuff.
Yeah, crazy, ain't it?
It is. It's very different nowadays. Okay, I'm going to move on to my number four. coming in at 6 minutes and 55 seconds long, a hair under 7 minutes. This album charted at number five. It's gone four or five times platinum. I've seen differing accounts, so I'm not sure if it's quadruple platinum or quintuple platinum from 1975. From Left Overture, it is, actually it's 1976, sorry. Cheyenne Anthem is my number four Kansas song. And it's got those little, those two little girls singing on parts of the song. So it's different song, and you get Walsh's great vocal on this song. And the song is about something. It's about the plight of the Native Americans. So that's the great thing about Kansas. They didn't write about just, you know, getting drunk and driving around and picking up girls, that kind of stuff. Their songs were a lot deeper. And that's Kerry Livgren's great mind and his great songwriting ability. So I just think this is an excellent song from a lyrical bent, from a lyrical slant. And just the music is great. Some great Kerry Livgren piano work, great guitar work, and just the whole band, as I said, pull together. And they just make this an upper echelon Kansas song. So Cheyenne Anthem is my number four.
All right. Number four, Cheyenne Anthem. Nice. I was thinking that that song might pop in here for you the way you talked about it on your album ranking review there. So that's not a surprise. And my number four is definitely no surprise. If you knew what my number five, you know, we mentioned what my number five was. My number four is also from Left Overture. And that's none other than the big song from Left Overture, which charted all the way up to number 11. And that's none other than Carry On, Wayward Son, one of the songs you just mentioned about, the one of the three songs you usually always hear by Kansas on classic rock radio today. Yep. It's like they just can't shy away from it. You know, obviously enough, this song is their biggest selling song as far as a single is concerned. It's four times platinum as a single, RIAA. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like I said, it peaked at number 11, which makes it the band's second highest charting single. And definitely, you know, it's one of those songs right away, as soon as they start singing, when it comes on the radio, right away you know the song, you know who's singing it, and bam, hits you right out of the gates. And it's one of their longer songs on the album, clocking in at 5 minutes on the album, 5 minutes and 26 seconds. There are single versions and shorter versions. But, you know, definitely one of those songs that you'll never forget when you hear it. And, of course, it was written by Kerry Livgren. And, you know, what else can be said about it? And another song, I like it just a little bit better than Point of No Return. Same situation. I hear it all the time. I'm still not sick of it. Probably never will be. And just a great song. A great song is a great song. And that's what we got here at my number four.
And it was just two fast things. It was a last-minute addition to the record because they were basically done, and Kerry Livgren brought another song in, and he played it for the guys. He said, okay, we love that song. Let's put it on the record, because the band was a democracy with all six guys, and they had to approve of a Walsh song or a Livgren song to work on it, work it up, and put it on the record. And another thing about this song, which I neglected to say when me, you, and Tom did the album ranking, is that this song was featured in every season of the TV show Supernatural, which was on for 15 years on the CW TV network. And it was always it was played in the season finale, Carry On Wayward Son, except for the first season, they used it in the next to last episode. Wow. So it got a second life, and Kansas got a lot of new younger fans because that song was played on TV every year. And that's a big show. For 15 years, they had like 357 episodes, I think. And I never watched it. I wasn't a fan, but I knew about the show and I knew that Kansas was played on it.
All right. Interesting. Well, we're really getting into it now. We got our top three coming.
Coming in at number three, a very, very deep cut for me. 8 minutes, 48 seconds long. Unfortunately, the record didn't chart, and I'm going back to it again from the year 2000, Somewhere to Elsewhere, Distant Vision. And this is a song that features vocals by Robbie Steinhardt and Steve Walsh. And it's the record where the group got back together and they cut a whole album of Livgren songs. And I just love this record, Somewhere to Elsewhere. It was on an independent label from upstate New York called Magna Carta Records. So it's not easy to find. And a lot of Kansas fans might not even know that it exists. But I think it's a stellar album. And Distant Vision is just one of those songs where the more I would hear it, the more it would hit me. And the instrumental interplay between the band on this song is phenomenal. And there's a part about two-thirds into the song where Steinhardt is singing and the band is playing. And it's just one of the most beautiful things, pieces of music in the whole Kansas catalog. And I love it. And I'm trying not to get choked up about it because it's very beautiful. So there, I'm going to take a sip of water. So at number three, Distant Vision, an amazing song. If you haven't heard it, you should go out and play it. Listen to it. Amazing song. Number three, Distant Vision.
All right. Well, my number three is going to probably surprise tons of people here. Will it surprise you?
Is it the one you hinted at? That's the one I'm wondering.
Nope. This one is the fourth and final song to crack the top 20. And it was on a return album entitled Power. And of course, we're talking about the Power ballad, All I Wanted. I've just loved that song from the first time I ever heard it. You know, it's just one of those songs that the Walsh vocal, man, it hits hard. Just to me, I don't know how everybody else feels about it. You know, a lot of people might not like the slower songs or the meaningful songs, but that song to me, just definitely one of my favorite all-time Kansas songs. You know, I mean, the two above it, you know, are just fantastic, or else it probably would have been number one. But number three, definitely, for me, is All I Wanted. It's probably his best vocal performance overall, just in the technique and the way he goes about singing the song. So, and you'll know why I say that, because the songs above it are not really a standard Walsh vocal, and one actually isn't a Walsh vocal at all. So that would explain why that other one isn't. But this one stands out mostly for the vocal performance for me.
Oh, he sings the heck out of it. It's a very good song. I always liked it when I first heard it on the radio 38 years ago, I guess, in 1986.
Wow.
That was the song they played on the radio.
Yeah.
So I fell in love with it back then. It's an excellent song. Didn't make my top 10, but it's on my larger list. And I knew it would be on your top 10.
All right. So now what do you got?
Number two, 6 minutes, 28 seconds long. A record we've discussed already that reached number five. That's four or five times platinum from Left Overture, 1976, Miracles Out of Nowhere.
I knew you were going to have that one.
Just Walsh's vocals on this song are amazing. When he and Steinhardt are singing, it's always here, it's always there. And then Walsh just goes, it's just love and miracles out of nowhere. And he just climbs, just that vocal is just amazing. And once again, just the instrumental underpinning of the song, the way all the musicians gather together and they support Kerry Livgren's great song. And they even use this song title for the documentary about Kansas from about 10 or 12 years ago, I think about 2010, 2012, they put out a documentary, a movie on the band called Miracles Out of Nowhere. So they think highly of it, and the fans love this song, and it's just an amazing song. I love it. The keyboard work is phenomenal, and that's all Walsh and Livgren. So at number two, Miracles Out of Nowhere.
All right, very good. Yeah, I had a feeling that was going to pop up there on your list. Seems like you find 6 minute songs and pick them or something. I don't know. You and your 6 minute. Yeah, I guess you really
that's
like
me.
the fullness of a song, because, you know, you get more so much involved, the complexity in a lot of these songs, a lot of the, you know, the really longer songs. And you like, it seems like you like the longer songs. I like the shorter songs. And this song here that I got at my number two is a classic example, and it's a classic song. And as far as what it is, it's coming from none other than The Point of No Return. And we're talking about another 3.5 minute song here that was written by Mr. Livgren there. And that's none other than the biggest Kansas song that ever charted as a single. We're talking Dust in the Wind here at number 6. It charted on their charts. 3 times platinum as far as sales are concerned. So although it's not their biggest selling single, it definitely was their highest charting single. Interesting how things like that work sometimes. You know, what can be said? You know, the work on Dust in the Wind, you know, it's just a gem. It's a classic rock staple. You know, if you did a countdown of the greatest classic rock songs, it has to be in like the top 25 of all time, just because of the how big the song is, as far as most radio stations when they do their famous countdowns of like of the top whatever classic rock songs. At Kansas, this song is usually the one that usually is on there. A lot of people always kind of lump it in with Stairway to Heaven in a way for some reason. It kind of is like their Stairway to Heaven if you think about it. You know, it's short though. It's not as long as, but it definitely had, with the acoustic, you know, the vocal performance, definitely a great song. You know, I can't say enough about Dust in the Wind. I've always loved it. The violin, yeah, and everything there, you know, just a great song. So my number two, and so far you were right. We have no songs the same. This is absolutely amazing. Now, will one of us slip up here with our number one?
And just to add about Dust in the Wind, it was a finger-picking exercise that Kerry Livgren used to do just to warm up. And his wife heard it, and she said, "Hey, what is that?" He's like, "Oh, I'm just practicing. It's a finger-picking exercise to get me loose." And she said, "You should write some lyrics to that. That's very catchy." And it became one of their two biggest songs. It's amazing when things work out like that.
Great lyrics, too.
My number one song,
drum roll,
comes in at 9 minutes and 44 seconds.
Wow.
An album that reached number 70 that went gold from 1975's Mask, the final song, The Pinnacle. And this is just Kansas at their best. And I've always loved this song. It's been my favorite song of Kansas for decades now. And the playing on it is great. The vocals, of course, by Steinhardt and Walsh. And just the songwriting by Kerry Livgren. Just an amazing song. It's magnificent. It's beautiful. And there's a great clip on YouTube. When you're done watching this video, you can go and watch this clip too. Kansas, because they were on Don Kirshner's label, they actually appeared on Don Kirshner's Rock Concert, the old TV show they used to run, I think, Friday nights, because Saturday Night Live was on NBC on Saturday. I think this was Friday, unless it was after Saturday Night Live, whatever. But Kansas did a bunch of songs on Don Kirshner's in the mid-70s, and they do a great version of The Pinnacle. And just Kerry's keyboard work in the song, and he switches from guitar to keyboard, keyboard to guitar. Guy's an amazing talent. And this is the pinnacle of Kansas' songwriting, and it's my number one song, The Pinnacle, from Mask, 1975.
Wow. Yeah, I didn't see that one coming. I don't think many people did. That's just good stuff there. Good stuff to, you know, it makes you want to go back and listen to it now to say, hey, why does Davey think this is number one? And now that I'm going to get a chance to go back and dig deeper, I'm going to be able to see, you know, too bad we couldn't do a follow-up video to say, well, after watching and listening to these songs of Davey's choices, here's what I came up with, you know, just to kind of give everybody, well, that's what the comments are for. Definitely leave the comments there. But before we do, you guys can either choke me or chastise me for my number one choice. And
it's not Get Rich, is it?
No, it's probably a surprise to some, but if you've been following along at home, this song that I'm about to pick charted. It was a single. It was released all the way in the year of 1982. We're going back to the very first album with Mr. John Elefante, and we're talking about Play the Game Tonight. Oh, man, I just cannot get enough of this song. It's just what a great song. You know, I got to play this song on 97 Rock once. It was awesome being able to do that. You know, when you get to be a DJ for like just for a day, and you get to play some of your favorite songs of all time on there, man, oh man, what a feeling it is, you know. But this song is definitely the pinnacle for me for Kansas songs. And it's oddly enough, because I love Walsh, yet I don't have Walsh as my number one song. That's strange in my opinion myself. I'm shocked myself. But this song is just, to me, just a great song from beginning to end. A great start with Elefante's Kansas career, you know, even though he only lasted two albums. Didn't really have a lot of hits, but, you know, three of his songs made it on my top 10, strangely enough. But Play the Game Tonight, you know, they got some airplay on that one, on the world famous MTV there. It was one of the first videos that ever, you know, came across, you know, the early 82, I believe. And just a great song. You know, I can't say enough about it. It's just one of those songs that has always moved me from day one. And I just enjoy it. We're peaking in at number 17 on the charts. And just, to me, the greatest Kansas song. Nothing more to be said for me.
It's got a great violin solo, nice piano work, and it's catchy.
Yeah, I love the lyrics.
The lyrics,
yeah.
And Walsh did sing this song. So this was an Elefante song that I definitely saw Kansas play this.
Yep, you definitely seen it. Yeah, on that Styx tour, Walsh did sing it live. Not sure if it was part of a medley that he did or if it was the full song. That's the only thing I can't remember. Remember seeing set lists about something about it being a part of a medley, but I had always thought that he sang the whole song, but I could be wrong. I don't know. I'd have to go back and research it more. But, you know, just when Walsh did sing it during that Styx concert, man, that was just great. The crowd really got into it to see Steve Walsh get up there and sing it, you know. You know, at that point, you know, he just came, you know, 96, that would have been. So that lineup during that time frame, you know, there's been, you know, a few lineup changes in this band's, you know, obviously when you've been around for as long as these guys have been, there's, you know, a lot of lineup changes. But the mainstays usually, you know, Mr. Williams, obviously, and Phil Ehart, they've been around forever. But sadly enough, if you're going to be catching Kansas on this tour that's going on right now as we speak, or Earhart isn't there, unfortunately, he had to take this tour off. But, you know, definitely if you can see these guys, definitely we highly recommend them. The new singer does a great job with the catalog, and these cats can still play the songs amazingly well. So there you have our top 10 songs. And if you want to give us a few of your honorable mentions real quick, just give us what you got there, that songs that came close, but they just couldn't make that crack that top 10.
Well, I have a top 20, so I'll just read through them and not mention any details about them. Here's one we had in common. My number 20 is All I Wanted from the Power album.
Oh, wow.
It's a great song. And like you said, it's an excellent Walsh vocal on that song. It's very catchy. I just wish they didn't cut the song down at the end, because you hear Steve Moore start going off on the guitar and then the song fades out. So I wish he could have had a really nice solo at the end. But maybe one day we'll get an expanded CD with an extra minute or two of Moore's song guitar there. Coming in at number 19, From Somewhere to Elsewhere, I had Look at the Time, which features Billy Greer on vocals. And it's a very Beatles-esque type song. And I just think it's very catchy. And it's a great song. Look at the Time. From their first album at number, from the Kansas album, Lonely Wind is a beautiful piano ballad that Livgren wrote back in the day. That's my number 18. 17, we have another one. Hold On. I had it number 17 because it's a great, catchy rock song with another sterling vocal by Mr., of course, Steve Walsh. Number 16, the epic Death of Mother Nature Suite, which is a prog masterpiece from their first album. Coming in at number 15, a song from Point of No Return that you did not have, the last song, all 7+ minutes of it, Hopelessly Human. Coming in at number 14, a 9-minute song from Somewhere to Elsewhere called Myriad, which is an excellent prog song. Number 13, I'm bouncing back to Point of No Return, Nobody's Home, the next to last song, which is proggy, and it just has some great catchy violin work and guitar work, keyboard work. Of course, it's Kansas. Number 12, the epic 8-minute song from the debut. I think it's the last song on the album. It is Journey from Mariebronn. And just towards the end of the song, there is a lift in this song, which is phenomenal. And you have Walsh wailing to the heavens, and you have Kerry Livgren on synthesizer. And just the band swells and the violin and the way that song ends and the way the first album ends, Journey from Mariebronn is an amazing piece of music. And then at number 11, from Point of No Return, the epic 6.5-minute Closet Chronicles, like the closet behind me. That is an amazing song, and it's about Howard Hughes. And it's 7 minutes of prog wonder. And I just love that song too, and I was crushed I couldn't get it into my top 10. So that's my whole top 20.
All right. So I just had a few honorable mentions. I only have three, actually. So I'll go with mine real quick. Number 13, Anything for You from Audio Visions. Kind of a song that just kind of is on the album. Never really got any just due. Definitely one for me that kind of stood out pretty good there. And number 12, here's one that nobody mentioned from Point of No Return. Any guesses?
Point of No Return?
Yeah.
Oh, not Portrait. You said Portrait.
I said the Portrait.
Other one. The other piece song.
The other piece song. Hey, there you go. None other than Paradox.
Paradox, that's
the second song on the album, co-written.
Flew right out of my head. That's
Walsh.
A great song.
Yeah. Yep. I almost made it, but not quite. And then, of course, another one that we actually had a same song, different area. I've got number 11 from Monolith, On the Other Side.
Nice.
Yeah. Great song.
Oh, yeah.
It almost made it. It was a battle, but it just didn't crack the top 10, unfortunately.
And I have to mention from Left Overture, The Wall.
Hmm.
Another amazing song.
Just there's probably a couple.
Vocal on The Wall is amazing, and that probably should be in my top 20. But
that's the problem. Everything can't be in the top 20. That's the reason why we have these lists, because you can't, you can't fit them all in there, unfortunately. Yep.
They have too many great songs. I'd rather do a top 50.
Oh God, we'll be here all day. But that's the beauty of a band. When you can do that, when you can literally sit down and rank 50 songs, you know you love the band. You know, I mean, there's no doubt about that, or you wouldn't be wasting your time trying to rank 50 songs. So, and that'd be something like trying to rank, for me, it'd be like me ranking Aerosmith or Kiss or Zeppelin. You know, it'd be so hard to pinpoint down which song is this, which, I mean, it's just too many variables, too many different types of music. Zeppelin had a lot of different styles, as you can tell, just from the Physical Graffiti album in itself and how the variety on that album. I think that's what makes that album so great, is the variety. You got the blues, you got the really hard rockers, you got something as great as 10 Years Gone. I mean, just an amazing, amazing album, you know. And this Kansas Collection, another just a phenomenal catalog by a band who, they don't get all the stuff that they deserve. This is one of those bands that just you know, they're still out there today, you know, regardless how many original members, this, that, or, you know, everybody likes to throw in, well, they don't got no originals or none of this or none of that. But, you know, who cares? You know, if the band is, it's got guys in the band that's been in the band a while. They're putting great performances on. They're keeping the catalog alive by performing the music, and they're making people happy.
Yep.
You know, I mean, that's the bottom line with some of these bands, you know, and it'd be different if you're out there just, you know, going through the motions on trying to keep the band out there and alive, and you're not performing it at, you know, at maximum capacity, or you're just not doing the group any justice. That's one thing, which there's bands out there like that, unfortunately, but, you know, these guys aren't them. These guys are definitely still going strong, and it's good to see.
And then there's also bands that use pre-recorded vocals live. Mm-hmm. They're just miming along. And the good thing about Kansas is they don't do that. So another reason to see them.
Might have been one of the reasons why Walsh left, because he knew his voice wasn't what it once was, you know, and he didn't want to have the performances, you know, be let down because of his vocal performance, because you know dang well that he could have still played if he wanted to. You know, the guy's a great keyboard player.
Yes.
But I seen him on, you know, one of the last tours that he was on, and although I personally didn't think it was, you know, a bad performance or anything like that, you could tell he was straining, you know, and not like he once was. If you've seen him before in the past, you could tell. You know, and he just probably felt, you know, it's time to retire. You know, some people do it at the right time, and then you got other people out there holding on to way longer than they should. And like you said, some of them are cheating by using pre-recorded tracks and, you know, not out there performing the music the way it really deserves, it should be performed as. And it's just a shame to see when there's, you know, so much they can get away with it nowadays, because people will still go see them no matter what. And it's just a shame when you see a great once band out there and they look like a laughing stock, you know, and this band isn't like that, thankfully. So that's why they get all my respect.
Yes, you are correct, sir.
All right. Any last things to add here? Can we let people know about your channel and other things that you want to share with us?
Yeah, sure. My channel is Cretin Classics, Cretin Classics, and it's on YouTube, and I only started it about 5 months ago, so there's content there, but I'm adding stuff all the time, and I have some nice Blue Oyster Cult content that's doing very well for me, so I'm happy about that. And I also, besides the fact that I did a Kansas ranking, and you, me, and Tom did a Kansas ranking about 5-6 months ago before I started my channel, I was on another channel called Curless Mania, Curless Mania as one word. And with the host, Tom Curless, and I, we did an album battle between Kansas Point of No Return and Kansas Left Overture. Which album did we like better and why? And it's a whole album study. So that's out there on YouTube also. So nice. I've done now, this is my fourth Kansas video on YouTube.
Yeah, you're an expert.
That's me.
An expert Kansas man here.
Thanks.
All right. So very
check
good.
Check out our album ranking that we did with Tom Jennings right here on Rock Show Critique from last October and November, I think it was.
Very good. Yeah, it was a great time. You know, we dig a little bit deeper into the albums, which is nice. You know, obviously, hopefully we gave you guys some insight on the, you know, with our top 10 selections. Those are songs that we definitely recommend to go back and give it a listen to, especially if you're not too familiar with some of these songs. You know, it's going to help, you know, open up the door, hopefully, to new things. That's the one thing I like about these album rankings is, like, whenever I got my guests on and they're throwing out songs and stuff that I'm not all, you know, I'm just not as familiar with it as some of the other songs of the catalog. You know, it really makes me go back and dig deeper and listen to them. And I find a lot of times I end up liking the band even more because I feel, you know, that, oh, wow, I didn't know about this song, man. great song, you know, and now I know. So it's really a great thing when we get to do these things. And I try to make sure that, you know, I knew in this case, I had a feeling that me and you were going to be on opposite ends of the spectrum as far as our songs were concerned. And that was exactly what it was. I mean, yeah. Who would have thought top 10 Kansas songs? You didn't really have any common songs in there. And I had, you know, a mix. I had some deep cuts, but not as many deep cuts as you had, obviously. But I think both of our choices are definitely, who can argue with them? You know, there are choices.
Precisely.
Everybody's got their own choices, you know, and you're going to like what you like right now. But let's just hope me and Davey here turned you guys on to something more so you can enjoy Kansas even deeper, a deeper
yes.
appreciation for the band. All
precisely.
Right.
Very well put.
All right. Well, great to have you on again. Once again, thanks for coming on and talking some Kansas, and good luck with your channel. And we will see you guys at our next album ranking.
Yep. Thanks for having me. Take care, everyone.